Hello everyone and welcome back to the SCG Game Night here at Grey Ogre Games. My name is Mick, I'm one of your hosts, and I will soon be joined by the Magic God Cass Ang. But right now I'm alone, so it's okay. We're watching the match between Jinjie and Brennan. Jinjie on the left, Brennan on the right. These two guys, new players, but they're joining the scene. Got to learn how to play Magic, got to get better. So we're definitely going to be... I would love to watch that game and see how this goes. Jinjie looks like he's playing an energy deck, gets two energy on top of that. And looks like Brennan is playing colorless Eldrazi. Looks like. Alright, so Turtle here, followed up by... Oh, it looks like mono blue. Alright, so we have what, two mono blue decks? This is going to be interesting. Puzzle Knot, Glass Blower's Puzzle Knot, getting him another 2 energy. He's going to be scrying through his deck. So good sequence of plays, and I think he can start swinging in. Well, it depends on what the energy is going to be used for. And if it's used for an Aetherworks Marvel, that'll be great. So he can actually, but if he's not using it for Aetherworks Marvel, he can start swinging with the Thriving Turtle. And so does he convert the energy? So here's the decision you have to make. You're not seeing anything inside, and so you change it for some energy. This will be able to survive. Well, right now it it'll be able to survive a Grass of Darkness. Oh no, it won't survive a Grass of Darkness, but it can definitely survive a minus Spatial Contortion +3/-3 spell, and a Thraben Inspector here gets him a clue, gets Brennan a clue. Jinjie here gonna go on another island. He has Engulfed the Shore in hand. This is a very, very cute deck. He is going to scry to get another 2 energy, go up to 4, and going to scry another 2, and decides to keep the second card on the top and bottoms the other card. He's going to swing in with his Turtle. Going to convert some energy as well into counters, and going back down to 2 energy. And Brennan decides to take 2, going down to 17. So now that turtle is safe. It is out of many harm's way. Oh, okay. So is Brennan playing a blue white? I'm confused now. I'm very confused. But these guys are new players, and they are trying to learn the game, trying to get better at the game. And right now, leaving up some mana, probably representing either a counter spell, or if nothing actually happens, then he can just crack the clue, bring back the... So he's going to swing in with just a 2-5. I say just a 2-5. And he's got Aether Squall Ancient. This is hilarious. This is fantastic. He decides to keep the Aether Squall Ancient on the top of the deck. So right now, Jinjie, if you're watching this, I think you want more lands, because the thing is that you have Engulfed the Shore in your hand, and keeping that Aether Squall Ancient on the top is not going to help you with much. And it looks like Brennan is playing something like a... wow, he's playing paradoxical outcome. This is cute. So he has Glimmer of Genius, which will give him more energy. He can swing in. So he's gonna play main phase. Well, that's the thing. Like, it's an instant speed card, so you can actually use it at instant speed. But he gets more energy. Goes up to 4. Gets to scry 2 and then draw 2 cards. And decides to keep one on the top and bottom the other one. And yeah, Jinjie, you got to tap your lands. Yep, that's right. Draws those 2 cards. And those 2 are lands, which is, well, what he really needs. And he can start swinging with the turtle right now and start converting energy into the turtle. He is ahead on life, and he does have Engulfed the Shore, which, he needs his turtle to be a bit bigger than that. So he's going to swing in, convert some energy. Brandon obviously refusing to block there. Let's see what's Brandon's plan though. I'm quite curious. He could get the endless one and get a 5-5 out of all of this, but that will not stop the turtle. The turtle will still keep beating in. And the problem is that Qin Jie has engulfed the shore, which means that he can actually just push back everything in Brandon's side of the board back to Brandon's hand. So, and saving his own turtle in the process. He could just cast it right now if he wanted to. And he will. He actually will. Alright, so engulf the shore here. Gonna push back everything on Brandon's side of the board. Oh man. And just gonna push everything on Brandon's side of the board back to his hand. Not gonna be able to use that paradoxical outcome very effectively yet. And Qin Jie, does he swing in? Does he remember to swing in? Come on, swing. And does he convert the energy? Nope. Brandon there going down to 9. Was he at 11? No, he was at 12. So he goes down to 9. I don't like that Qin Jie doesn't change the change it to be more powerful. You are on the play, and that actually increases the clock to 2. So here goes 2 more of the Thraben inspectors. He's gonna get 2 more clues. He has enough mana to play paradoxical outcome, so he can block, play paradoxical outcome. And just get to draw a hell of cards. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. And he gets to draw 4 cards from there, and then he will have 12 cards in hand. Of course, he can just draw from the clues. So it goes back to Qin Jie's turn. He has a lot of mana right now. And gonna go Glimmer of Genius. Brandon, nothing to respond to that. And gets Qin Jie up to 6 energy now. Sorry, up to 4 energy, not 6 energy. And draws another turtle, which is great. He could cast the Theorist. Yep, either Theorist, gonna hit the battlefield, get him another 3 energy. And when he casts that Aether Squall Ancient next turn, I believe there is enough lands. And he's like, wait. Hidden card error. No, it's actually looking at extra cards, and I don't have my phone with me, but I can go and find the looking at extra cards. All right, so then the IPG. So now we're going to talk about looking at extra cards, and this is this was of course drafted in 2014. We have a different type of IPG infraction procedure guide for looking at extra cards, but where else?
I think this was when the Courser was more prevalent.
Correct. So that was the main problem lah when you look at extra cards.
Yeah, the main of the card. Sometimes you don't flip the top, sometimes you flip when it's not around.
Alright, so looking at extra... There we go. Okay, so 2.2, GPE, gameplay error, looking at extra cards, there's a warning. The remedy is... a player looks at extra card... looks at a card that they were not entitled to see. Players are considered to have looked at a card when they have been able to observe the face of a hidden card, or when a card is moved any significant number amount from a deck but before it touches the other cards in hand, so the set. The penalty is applied only once if one or more cards are seen in the same action or sequence of actions. They actually get a penalty, which is a warning. If they do it again, it gets upgraded. So additional remedy, shuffle the randomized portion of the deck, which may include the cards that were seen if they were part of the random portion of the library. This requires first determining whether any portion of the deck is a non-random. Okay, so I decided not to penalize the two. I decided not to penalize Qin Jie by shuffling his deck. I knew what the thing was, but I chose not to do it because they are new players. Yeah. They are new to the game, need to understand that, you know, you can't just anyhow make up rules on your own.
I mean, yeah, these two kids are very entrepreneurship players.
Yeah,
they always buy the cheap common MTG Goldfish budget decks, and they're learning pretty quickly lah. But you know, obviously, sometimes you play with the pace of your opponent. You play a bit too fast, you know. Sometimes, you know, mistakes will happen.
Okay, so actually he gains 2 life there. Because Aetherflux Reservoir was the first card.
Oh my god, it's Aetherflux Reservoir.
So he gains 3 life.
Okay.
Yeah, this is the Bone Saw. Yeah, this is the Bone Saw. Bone Saw. So he actually could have cast the other Aetherflux Reservoir, by the way, and actually go up to 50 life. So this is the one, a paradoxical
outcome?
Outcome, yeah. So this is actually the 5th spell, by the way. So they're resolving triggers wrongly, but I'm going to let that go. I'm really going to let that go.
Because this is sequencing of wrong triggers. And if you make...
It's not sequencing of wrong triggers, it's resolving triggers wrongly.
Okay.
Which we actually discussed in today's episode. And you are not there.
Don't hate
You're
me.
Not there.
Don't hate
and
the
you
player.
Don't know what the actually
don't
remedy
hate the,
is.
Don't hate the player, man. Hate the game, man. Hate the game. Hate the education game, son. But yeah, I mean... I mean, he has to live with the punishment of the sequencing, resolving triggers.
Okay, so actually, in actual fact,
okay,
when you do see wrong resolution of a trigger,
right,
or ability, or a replacement effect,
okay,
you're supposed to correct it. You're supposed to pause. As a judge, like, you're supposed to, I believe you're supposed to intervene. Everything that I've seen on the internet, by the way.
I want to stop you right there. So actually, this happened, I think, in games day. So what happens if a player spots a mistake? Like, the ongoing game, there's a,
you ask your question after that. Remember the question though.
Okay.
Everything I've been reading on the internet says, like, there's two sides to the argument. Anyway, continue.
Okay, so what happens
if the player,
let's say a player spectating a game, he didn't comment on the mistake or the, you know, the, like the example with you using today in the podcast,
uh-huh,
where Kalitas and Fiend Hunter is in play.
Correct.
There's a,
and then you sacrifice the Fiend Hunter, right. You know, or you, player A has Kalitas, player B has creature, has creature, player B's creature dies. They both acknowledge that it gets exiled, but player A did not put a 2-2 zombie. So the problem with that is how Kalitas is worded. The entire thing is not a trigger. It's a replacement effect, and you're supposed to resolve the entire replacement effect correctly. So what happens if you're the player? Okay, so to know what the answer is, whether you intervene or not, do listen to the Power 9 podcast. But Where what you're asking
is if a player,
sees that.
And
okay.
He tells the judge. What does the judge do then?
Alright, so what does the judge do then?
Yeah, because it is not the judge that witnessed the event of a
wrong
resolution of a trigger, a replacement effect of trigger.
Alright, so there are some judges, because there's nothing in IPG about this, and some judges will tell you don't intervene. Assuming random spectator must ask the two players, correct. Wow, Chris Krypton, either you've been watching the podcast or you've been listening to the podcast, or you're a judge yourself.
Mick loves you.
Yeah. I love you.
If
because I always say,
if
always
you're a
say,
girl, make a single. Although, you know, I'm rooting for him for this.
Christine.
Under girl.
Maybe it's Christine Krypton. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, anyway, so what I was saying was that so the player, I know the player is supposed to pause the game and then call the judge and stuff like that. You tell the players, guys, can you wait? Then call the judge and then explain to the judge what happened.
Okay.
You don't let the game keep going on. So if you let the game keep going on, there's going to be bad stuff.
Okay, so bad stuff in a scenario where, let's say this occurs, but the player who witnessed the event didn't tell them to pause the game.
When the judge comes, it's the judge's discretion. The judge is supposed to investigate. So we pause the game at that point. Okay. We investigate what has happened up to that point. So we don't rewind yet.
Okay.
We just ask what has happened. So before this, before we pause the game, what happened? Before this, what happened? Before this, what happened? If people can recollect what has happened all the way to that point, then we rectify the issue by either putting the trigger or putting the effect back on the putting the effect back into play.
Okay. Such as putting the 2/2 zombie into play, right?
Correct. But generally, if things have gone way past, especially if you pass your turn and the guy's drawn a card, and especially if he's cast a single spell,
right,
you will just, because this changes the lines of play,
right,
then you have to rewind way too much.
I'm not a judge. I mean, I failed my judge test, you know, because, you know, somebody somebody scammed me into saying that after 2 months of Magic, you know, I should be competent enough to take the test. Apparently, not so.
That's another story.
Backstory aside, as a judge, how do you determine if the player is taking advantage of knowing that the opponent didn't resolve the full replacement effect?
Okay.
How do you determine if it's a malicious intent or innocent mistake of both parties?
You can't. Okay, so you can't. There's actually something in the IPG where it says that you can use the rules of the game. You can use the rules of the game to your knowledge, to the best of your knowledge, to gain all the advantage that you can, but only through knowing the rules. Mm-hmm. If, with the exception of detrimental triggers can get you a game loss, and if suspected to be cheating, then that will get you a DQ. That's the only exception.
Okay.
But generally, if let's say your opponent forgot or your opponent is saying, you don't tell them, but you knew in your heart, deep heart, you know, then too bad.
Yeah.
So the best example I can give you is that there's this very obscure thing called establishing shortcuts. Okay. And we talked about this on the podcast, power9podcast.com. or YouTube,
right,
whatever.
Okay.
So,
cool.
I'm not sure at Timerson, I just heard them talking about it while I was eating. Okay, so there's this thing called establishing shortcuts.
Okay.
And there is this established shortcut where you say combat, ? Or go to combat.
Okay.
You actually, and if your opponent says yes, you actually skip the start of combat entirely. You go to declare a stack, attacker stack. For those of you at home who know, there is this thing called start of combat.
Yeah,
so
for those who play Modo, especially
those of you who play Modo, you know there's a start of combat and then declare attackers and then declare blockers and so forth and so on, and then the damage step, and you know there's a few intricacies, but when you know the rules, you know, then you can, basically, I won't say trick your opponent, but you can
use certain words to
Alright. You know, go to combat question mark, and then your opponent chooses not to like tap down your creatures at the start of combat. And your opponent says yes.
Right.
And then it's too late for you to cast that cryptic command. It's too late for you to cast that that surge of whatever. This surge of no, there's one in the current standard format where you tap down a creature and draw a card. Whatever.
I can't remember.
You surge it, it has surge in it.
Okay. I mean
okay, so yeah, but that's tough beans for you because that was part of the rules.
I mean, I'm sorry, and if you knew the rules on the game, but I feel that this is kind of informative.
Yeah.
So what happens if, let's say, you use these shortcuts, right? So you say combat, and your opponent says yes, and he declares attackers, but actually, he realized that he actually skipped the start of combat. And then, what happens then? So it's just too bad, right?
That's too bad. Like, then you call in a judge.
Okay.
So if you're not happy, then you call in a judge. And then the judge comes by, and you ask exactly what did they say.
Okay.
And both of them need to corroborate the story, unlike...
the same exact story,
so
right?
If they both agree on the story of what happened...
Okay.
Then you make your decision, sorry, but there is this thing in the IPG and you show them the IPG, you probably can show them the IPG, that there's this thing called established shortcuts.
Right, okay.
And there are 11 of them. Go study it for those of you who play competitive Magic. And then you show your opponent, okay, so he did say this, he was trying to say this, you know.
Okay.
And... You know, that's what happens, and then you tell your opponent, okay, but the next time you say something else.
Yeah.
You know? So you have established shortcuts and you can establish new ones during the game.
Right, okay.
But you have to whenever you don't want to, you have to not say backtrack lah, but you have to stop lah.
Yeah.
You have to change the way you say things. Anyway.
Okay, I see. That's
cool. You get the idea, yeah, right? The first time, like, okay, let's like, the second time is, you know, the second time then really is your mistake.
Yeah.
Now that you know the rules.
Right.
Anyway, wow, this is a complex board state.
I'm quite sure that Brandon is not doing the Aetherflux triggers properly.
Nope.
If you have 3 Aetherflux and you cast one spell,
you get 3 life.
Yeah.
Why is he doing?
I don't know.
I'm not watching.
I think he gained the wrong amount of life, but...
He gained, what, 6 life off of the first spell, is it?
I think he gained, like, 2.
Oh, okay.
But I could have saw wrong because, you know, I like to look at people when I talk to them. So, I looked halfway.
Okay, and then you were like, the eyes were not there.
The eyes, baby.
Alright, so...
Look at them turtles.
Turtle power! Turtle power. You'll never have to worry about stuff like that at Friday Night Magic.
I know some people who will do these kinds of things, lah.
Oh man, don't we all?
Yeah. I mean,
it's casual. Okay, so that's the thing. So, the way you judge.
Oh, that boss. By the way, that boss move, man. He just gains all the life. It's like declare attacks.
It's like okay, I'll go to 41. I'll go back down to 29. It's okay.
Like,
I'll go again. Holy crap! Did he just draw a paradoxical
outcome?
Oh yeah, paradoxical outcome. Yeah, scoop.
Negate.
Nagate.
Oh, by the way, that's not actually BM because they are two.
Yeah, they're two friends.
And
yeah,
they started
yeah.
Magic at the same time, so they're not really nice friends to each other.
Nagate! So he's gonna crack the Terrarion for double white now. Okay, well, what was the question? Yeah, okay, so yeah, Chris Krypton, you're right. It's more competitive tournament level lingo, but there definitely are players in FNM that will bring this, kind of things up. Well, you know, you can't stop them.
It's good to know because you might run into one of these players.
That's
and
correct.
It's better to know the rules and the proper procedures than not know it at all and then go home after night of Friday Night Magic and feel like, hey man, I feel like I got cheated because he chose some shortcuts which I didn't know you could do.
Yeah, he said something and, you know, at the end of the day, we talk about, you know, Magic the Gathering. At the end of the day, as a judge, especially for FNM, at regular REL, and this tournament is held at regular REL, you're trying to get the players to have fun.
Yeah.
You know, sure. If the players are not having fun, then there's a problem either with you or with another player. Yep. So, or with that player. Yeah, that's true. Definitely prefer it happens at FNM that somebody tells you the rules. Yeah. But not to rules lawyer you, not to like be a bastard and just BM you to the max. But to educate you. And that's important. Whoa, did he just draw a Dynamo Tower? Oh no.
Oh no.
He scribed the Dynamo Tower to the bottom.
That's weird.
Yeah. Well, maybe he's got, you know, if he's got another Aether Squad Ancient, that would be great. So he's gonna mill his opponent for 3 more cards.
Man. All I care is that the turtles are powering up, man. I don't even see that in limited, by the way.
I got a 6/9 turtle before.
Why? Oh god.
Oh yeah, because my opponent just let me. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna swing in. And then I'm gonna put more counters. Oh. It was not because I was powering up with energy, but I already had the first counter. Not Glimmer of Genius. I was using animation module. Oh. It's like, yeah, I'm going to put more counters on this guy. Yeah, I'm going to put more counters on this guy and this guy and this guy and this guy and this guy.
Yeah, removals in limited, right?
I don't care, but it's the only... It was one of the few creatures where I had actually power +1/+1 counter and then I could get a servo out of it.
Right, okay, fair.
So then I just keep getting servos out of it and the last turn I cast an Inspired Charge. As I look at my opponent, I think you dropped him like from 20 life to 0.
Tortoise,
like
man.
One attack.
Tortoise is ridiculous.
Stupid Tortoise.
It's the same thieving grub and all that weird stuff.
Alright, Chris Krypton. You're from Canada, yeah? Those are Grey Ogre Games Energy tokens.
Yeah.
And those are only available in Singapore and sometimes at a GP near you. Are we going for any GPs lately?
Mean,
no.
Not right now.
Not right now, yeah. So Ben has
give me some, like, type of something.
Yeah. And please pass it to Mark because he's supposed to take some and pass to Andrea. Okay, cool. Yeah. So you can have the we'll take it to Mark.
You need to hold the whole box on.
Yeah. we also have clue tokens. If you can't see it, actually, we do have these like Emrah clue tokens,
yep,
which were funny when SOI was out, but not funny now.
We like to establish dominance by creating products with our branding.
Oh yeah,
even though we are not really establishing.
That was a Power 9 podcast token, by the way.
Man,
whatever.
That sell out, baby. Sell it. I can feel it from here, man.
I didn't sell it. We gave it out. We gave it to all the stores in this thing. Holy crap!
What?
This is weird. So, is he going to mill Brandon to death?
I think this game ended... I mean, I'm sorry to say, the new player, but I think this game ended a while ago.
Yeah.
I just don't know what's happening anymore.
Exactly. Okay, so we're going to...
Maybe this is the infamous 15-minute game one Aetherflux Reservoir that they were talking about.
No, that's the wrong
like
one.
Like, you give your opponent that glimmer of chance, but actually you've got the game so bad in your hand.
Okay, so we're going to leave Jinjie and Brandon to have their own set of fun because I think, you know, Brandon doesn't have a way to deal with the two Master of Inquiries.
And the two turtles that
and
are powering
the two turtles,
up.
Yeah, the two giant turtles. You know, I think the paradoxical outcome.
He
what?
Casts,
he casts a sequence of three spells, gain 9 life.
Shores. He just casts Angle of the Shores and like herpadoop,
Okay, we're going to transition over to Peng Jie versus Jian Hao.
Okay, Peng Jie is playing a different deck.
Black Green Delirium.
Good stuff, man.
Yeah. So, yeah, enough fun for the night. We'll get back to business. Cause I was bored watching actual players play the game, like good players. I wasn't, no, not good players, but experienced players who are also good players, by the way. So
Man,
see how looking staring down the barrel of a gun. Like, how am I gonna do this?
If I look, I mean, if my opponent has Ishkana Liliana at 7 and he has 5 spiders and a mind rank demon, I will probably ask myself, how did this happen? And
how did we get here?
Why am I here? Like, am I lost?
How did we get here? No, but he does have a license disintegration in hand, so he
but
can just unlicense.
Liliana's gonna untap in the ulti.
No, you unlicense disintegration,
and then you redirect it.
And then redirect the 3 damage to Liliana.
You know, with the stuff you have on board, it's just gonna tick up and up and up. And
then how don't let him. Oh no,
regrets.
He's gonna ulti the.
No, he can
the
still
Liliana.
Doing the draw stat.
Yeah, but chooses not to.
Okay, maybe he doesn't know that. If he goes to main phase, the priority is with Peng Jie.
Oh no. He could have done it there. He could have done it there with the evolving wild still on the stack. No! Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it.
I'm going. We're going to watch what we call not knowing the steps. Tian Hao is probably going to unlicense disintegration the Ishkana and then be like, wait, I'm going to response and unlicense disintegration redirect.
Oh no.
He actually just lets it go. Okay.
Oh no. Has he like given up? Like okay.
Like, you know what? You know, yes. I'm here for magic. I'm just going to stay and play my game.
And, you know, I'm like, okay.
This is the poker tail. When Tian Hao looks at the Amraku being cast, he just like sits back and his arms just drop. You know,
has been disintegrated. He could have stopped the first one, but he definitely couldn't stop the Amraku.
Actually,
he could have stopped the Amraku because... Oh, no, he couldn't. Peng Jie still had one more land, which means that he could definitely cast the Amraku.
Even without Amraku, you are very far behind on that board state.
Oh, for sure.
You know, if you're playing black-red, reanimate dredge.
The dredge and the like aggressive dredge version.
And your five spiders, Ishkana, Liliana, and a Mindwreck Demon, I think you just, I don't know, just like, take a blanket, cover yourself.
Lie on the floor, try not to cry.
Take a hot cup of cocoa and ask yourself, do I still keep playing this game?
It looks like the game is done.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay. Shall we end the stream here?
Do we want to go back to Brandon's
game?
And then we can advise them on the trigger. Oh, they're fucking out.
That is game one. That was game one for sure.
Man, so, this deck is just
the bane.
Yeah, the bane of all existence. Okay. The only thing I remember being able to do this was like playing blue black control in standard.
Ashok.
You just sit there and you're like, bounce my Radiant Fountains and lay a land, gain 2 life, lay a land, gain 2 life, lay a land, gain 2 life, thing like,
You know, I used to play in Porto, and they're gonna pack it up. Okay.
Oh, okay. Another advice for new players, if you go to a PBDQ and you somehow magically hit top 8, please bring a deck box that only contains one deck,
yes.
Please do not bring a deck box like that. You can bring it around, but only have one deck inside.
Yes, correct.
Yes, because you don't want cards to get... What's the penalty for it?
DDLP, deck list error.
Oh, so they get a game loss?
They get a game loss only.
Oh my goodness.
I mean,
it's an in and winning for your opponent, but you know...
Yeah, exactly. It's a game loss for you. Right? DDLP is not cool. Deck something... I'm glad you guys are streaming this though. It's fun to watch standard. Yeah, it's also fun to watch like two idiots like talking rot. Back to the story about me playing in Porto and about Ashok and
no one cares.
Nobody cares, right? No, but there was this guy who basically plays only control decks. Only has played control deck. Standard, modern, legacy.
Why?
He plays control. And I don't understand why, but yeah, we call him Jose, who only plays counter spells. But anyway,
Jose counter spell.
Jose,
did you say counter spell, Jose?
did you say counter spell?
Yeah, but I mean, I think that people have a misconception that control decks are the premium decks to play, because they look very difficult to play from an outside view, but it feels like. When players watch the Pro Tour and they see people like
Shota,
wrecking his opponents with his control.
What's his name? What's the American dude's name?
I want to say Andrew, who played
the black white control.
Seth
Manfield.
Yeah, Seth Manfield.
Best control player ever.
No, man.
Hands down.
Actually, I think.
Hands down!
I think
Shut up!
I think Ivan Flock is a bit better.
Simply
because he played in a time.
Yeah, okay,
the blue white Sphinx Revelation Mirror was in around.
Okay, that's true lah. Yeah, Ivan. Okay, so it's a toss up. I always say like Ivan Flop, Shota, and Seth Manfield. Yeah. These three guys are like the best control players. They're the same. But Jinjie here dropping turtle. He's winning again with the turtle.
It's turtle win game, boys.
Turtle gonna win him the game.
Yeah, I mean. Yeah, I think people have this misconception that control decks are the best deck to play. Honestly, yeah. I really think that if you're a good player, no matter what deck you play, you'll be good.
Yeah, that's right.
You just have to deal with the meta appropriately.
Maybe the comfort level, your comfort level is not that high. You spend more energy thinking of plays and shit like that. Yeah. But, if you're a good player, you know how to...
You can do decently well with it.
Yeah.
Oh, I know.
But anyway, back to that story. I still haven't finished the goddamn story. What the hell are you trying to do, man?
No, but you already mentioned his name. Jose only counterspells.
Well, no. The whole point was that, okay, like, we get matched up so often. We both play the same deck.
Right.
We get matched up so often that, especially he plays the Ashok, like, control deck. Right. He slams it down turn 3, and this is post-ball. He slams it down turn 3, looks at me. You got one blue mana up. Stubborn Denial? Yes, Stubborn Denial. And then he proceeds to just scoop. Because he knows that, like, he sees two mana up or, like, one mana up. He looks at me, like, I gotta slam it. Like, he knows.
No, but that's the format with Heroes Downfall. The game is not lost.
I did not play Heroes Downfall. Wow, I played one Heroes Downfall in the deck. Because my deck is meant to. So I play the CDC. I play the CDC Whip deck.
Right,
is totally different CDC
Whip
that's deck.
It's a different control deck.
It plays, no, it's not a control deck. I play the aggressive.
It's like a mid-range reanimate deck.
Mine is the aggro version. Really? Mine is like the turn two get the Hooting Mandrills type of deck. So
you want to cast Tarmogoyf in standard, right?
Yeah, I'll cast better than freaking Tarmogoyf. 4-4 Trample. 4-4 Trample on turn 2.
Cast the fish, man. The Gurmag Angler, boys.
Nah, Gurmag Angler. Well, that was before the Gurmag Angler. And when the Gurmag Angler came out, I switched to Tarsigur. Tarsigur is so much better.
It's really started card, really.
So yeah, turn two basically I can pull off this thing. That was the deck.
They could have made a more dirty card for the Jun and the
Shulk, right?
The Jun and Junk deck.
Junk deck, yeah.
You know, the removal Tarsis, Delph,
Tarsigur, like,
why is this happening to me? did I like kick an old lady to the street or something? You know?
But yeah, I'm pretty sure there's always this like people who always play the same decks.
Yeah, yeah.
I am maybe not one of them, like, I definitely have like two decks, like one fun deck, basically like one Jeffrey deck.
Yeah.
And then like one like deck. proper like competitive deck.
I'm actually a fan of, I don't know, you guys don't hear Joe often, but he's a guy working at the store.
Oh man,
he,
Joe.
All the decks that he likes to play, I like to play. When he lent me his Lens Legacy deck, I almost instantaneously knew how to play the deck. It was ridiculous. It was like playing Abzan Coco, but now you're using Lens and it's so...
But Lens is normal. I mean, Lens is like an established
deck, so it's Abzan Coco in Modern, but... I don't know. I like to play decks with a lot of lines of play. It makes me feel smart when I do something good.
Yeah, but you're not.
Hey man. Hey man. Like I said,
don't trample on my dreams.
Don't watch the YouTube playbacks of me playing any game on stream because they all end badly. But off stream, I'm actually not that bad of a player. I think.
You think so? You think so?
Yeah, I think so.
Clearly, this thing. Did Brandon not draw for his turn? By the way,
I don't know. I mean, I think when you're this new at the game, you should probably take your turns a bit slower.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can not be anal about it, but you should untap your lands first before you draw.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah, I mean, that's proper turns in Magic.
Dynavolt Tower here. And Dynavolt Tower Pumler? Got a lot...
Is that Pumler? It is a Pumler.
Yeah, that's Electrostatic Pummeler. Wow. So this is like pure energy deck, you know, like this
I think you could splash in green for Blossoming Defense, Servant of the Conduit to ramp up to your Aether Squall Ancient.
I don't think you should be playing Aether Squall Ancient in any case.
But I mean, for his budget, I think splashing that green, having for like the Servant of the Conduit.
Yeah, but if you splash green, then you'd have to play...
You can play Hive as well.
Yeah, no, but then you have to play... Well, you play Evolving Wilds for a budget deck.
Yeah.
And you'd also play... Oh man, he's getting gained alive. You also play... Oh, take the Aether Flux Reservoir. Yummy. You also want to play like Blooming Marsh. Not Blooming Marsh, the Botanical Sanctums. You also want to play like Lumbering Falls.
I mean,
then your deck becomes not cheap.
You can play the Oath Tap Lands for the dual lands.
Okay, so you can play the Oath Tap Lands. You can also play the SOI. I think the SOI Tap Lands are enemy colored. Are they enemy colored? Yeah, SOI Tap Lands are enemy colored. So you could play those, I know, but you know. Why would you slide yourself and not play right?
But you're playing turtles, man. I mean...
Okay, that's true.
Jin Jie looks like a smart kid and so does Brennan. But, you know, when you're playing turtles, you know... I mean, I don't consider myself an expert at Magic, but when I see turtles constructed, I tend to question what... I might be afraid. Like, what's going on, guys? is this, like, some new deck that I've not seen?
Yeah, he drew... Yeah, he drew the two clues. Well, I'm not gonna. I can't. Yeah, we can't rewind at this point of time. And he did mill with a paradoxical.
Well, can you imagine if you drew a clue into your hand?
Sorry, he drew from the two clues. He didn't draw for his turn. Right. All right, so lots of things for Tintia and Brandon to review.
Yeah, for new players, play a bit slower. You know, you don't.
Right.
Yes, there is a time limit.
Don't rush.
It's better than rushing and all making the wrong decisions.
Don't rush, just be patient with your game. Think your turns through. Don't take too long, but think your turns through and definitely play more.
Yeah.
So when you play more, Endless One's gonna be huge. 1, 2, 3.
Best card.
So when you play more, then you get to you play more, then you get used to how your deck operates. And I am kind of a stickler for this because I play that way. You untap your lands first.
Yeah, because
you untap everything first and then you start your turn.
Especially when you play like Vendilion Clicks cards like that where your upkeep
your draw stop, your draw step
is actually a crucial point. Like if you're gonna click, you're gonna do it during the draw step, right?
Mm-hmm.
You want him to get an extra card so you get an extra intel. Same with Elder Fiend. You don't want your opponent to be like tapping later and then he redrew his card, you know, untaps and draws his cards and like...
Yeah, I know, then like... Yeah.
Right?
So...
And it causes the judge a bit of trouble as well because they have to call the judge to the table, get a resolution. It's a whole bunch of unnecessary time.
How does he get 3 blue mana?
Oh,
wait, go out. He can't cast that.
Which one? Do you know the mistake?
So he cast the... Well, okay, so he could have reversed the play. So, Tintia, I'm not going to stop you now, but if you're watching this video, you know, remember that you have colors does not tap for blue.
Yeah.
And when you play your spells, like sequence it correctly.
Because competitive Aria, once you tap for the mana, you can't say that I'm going to cast 2 spells in a row because... Hey man, if you can cast 2 spells in a row and not instant speed, that's a new card. I haven't seen, man. That's like split second.
Oh points. My gosh, and looks like Brandon's just going to fire off the machine gun. Yeah. Not the machine gun, but the Aether Flux Reservoir.
Yeah, why would the reservoir have damage? I don't understand.
Eh? Oh, he can't cast any more spells.
But
oh, no.
I mean, he's dead on next turn, right?
Yeah.
I mean, or so, you could hit him down. To the point where if he drops one spell, he doesn't have enough to pay 50 life and do 50 damage.
He's gonna fumigate next turn.
Yeah, yeah.
And then gain life from the fumigate as well, by the way.
I think, now, you know, looking
and at... And Brand and Cynthia has just creatures in hand.
Looking at the Bonesaw version of the Aether Flux, the Reservoir deck.
A lot more fun, right?
Like restore the
restore balance. Yeah, that's the whole point. That's why Sigarda's 8 was like so hyped up. Yeah. That's why we told you to buy Sigarda's 8.
I said Sigarda's 8 as well. When it came out, I was like saying, dude, this is a good card. And people are like, nah,
and we did say no, but Sigarda's 8 right now is still the same price as it was back then.
Out of standard in Boggles, you will... I mean, the minute you have a Hexproof, it doesn't matter whether you cast it at instant speed or not.
Yeah.
Primarily, you will stick it on because there's extra points of damage. There's extra.
Oh, boys, you should not be doing that in front of the camera.
What's happening?
Yep, I'm going to transition for a while. Yep. Boys, if you're watching, please don't do that next time. Not in front of the camera. You see what they're doing?
I see.
You see what they're doing?
I see small black cubes flying around.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say what's happening. By the way, this is not acceptable at
any level of game. Okay,
especially
so.
If a judge is watching your feature match or your table. Please do not do this. Don't slip your guy. Don't slip. Open a piece of paper with a number on it. Don't say PayPal.
Don't say PayPal. Yeah.
Don't roll a dice or ask your opponent, dude. Concede lah.
Jeffrey, like okay. I don't know whether Jeffrey knows we're talking about him, but yeah.
I think Jeffrey.
Jeffrey knows, like, yeah, you know.
It's a long-standing joke. Jeffrey is one of the best players in the shops, but he committed a LP mistake and got banned for
6 months. All right, we're going to go off for the night. Thanks for joining us at the SCG Game Night. We hope to see you tomorrow.
And
remember,
thank you to
Chris Krypton and Timerson.
Your inputs have been awesome.
Yeah,
you know,
we love.
Is awesome.
We love chat activity, and I wish we had more, goddammit. Anyway, we're going to go out for the night. Before we go, just want to remind you, or if you're new to all of this, that Tuesdays and Wednesdays we have the streams. Also on the weekends, but we don't stream all the weekend stuff to find out whether we do stream it on the weekends. Follow our Twitch channel, follow our Facebook page. All the links are in the description below. If you miss those tournaments, it's okay. Go down to youtube.com/greyogregames to watch all the replays, because we upload all our stuff. Last but not least, do listen to the Power9 podcast. Myself and Alfian and Cass, we get together every week and we talk shop about this very obscure, very hard to understand. Magic the Gathering? Magic the Goldering?
Goldering? It sounds
familiar
with Goldering though.
Yeah, okay. Alright, thanks Chris Krypton. So this week we talk about Modern and we say, Modern is dead. Cass has no say in this. So if you want to know more, do go down to power9podcast.com. So for myself and Cass, we are signing off for the night. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you guys next time. Ciao.